Hi, this is COMP1010 at the University of Manitoba. I'm Dr. Celine Latulip, and today I'm going to talk to you about math functions, including things like min and max and random. We'll see how to use these in processing. So here's a set of useful built-in functions. First, min and max. So you can call min and pass in two ints, say 5 and 10, and it'll return the min of those, so it would return 5. And max would return 10. You could also call these but pass in float numbers, and it would return the min or the max as a float. Other functions include the square root function, which takes a float and then returns the square root of that number as a float. You can also square a number, so if you send 25 into square, it will return 25 times 25. And then the absolute value. And there's a float version of absolute value and an int version of absolute value. So for both of these, if you send in a negative number, you'll get that number back, but as a positive number. And then random, which is one of the most fun functions that we'll use with processing. If you pass a number into random, like 10, you will get a number back that is some random number between 0 and 10. You won't get 10, though. You'll get maybe 9.99. And of course, random uses floats. And there's another version of random that can be quite useful where you pass in two numbers. So for example, if I passed in 10 and 100 to random, I'd get a number that was somewhere between 10 and 99.99. And so that can be useful. All right, so when we pass in a number to random, we pass in, if we're just passing in one, we pass in the high end of the range, and it will give us a number between zero and that number. So it will give us zero. It won't actually give us the high number. It will give us anything up to, but not including it. So if we pass in 5, we'll get a number up to 0 to 4, especially if we're going to save it to an int. Okay, so random returns a float. So you can't really actually save it to an int unless you force it to be an int using a cast. So let's have a look at random. So random always returns a number that you can use anywhere. So you can use it in the middle of your drawing calls like rect and ellipse and line. You can use it when you're making colors and so on. And we can print random numbers out and see that every time we call, we run a program, random will give us something different. Okay, so let's have a look at what this looks like in a script here. We'll do print lon random 10, and we'll just run that. And we see that we get this number here, 5.9988565. If we run it again, we get a different number, 0.8765. If we run it one more time, this time we got 0.0922. So you see, random, every time he runs a program, gives us a random number in return, but it's always going to be in the range we specify. Now, if we did something like we want a random number between 10 and 20, then we'll see that that changes. So now we're getting 18.08, okay? And if we run it again, we get 14.39. All right, so pretty useful. So let's have a look at what you could actually do with random that's kind of fun. So let's see here, random lines. All right, so here we're using random in a different, couple of different ways. We're using random to specify what colors we want for some lines. So for the red value, we're saying we want a high red value, something between 100 and 255. So that's gonna give us a lot of red. And for the green and blue, we're actually getting low values, something between 0 and 100, okay? So this is not a lot of green or blue, but lots of red. So this is going to give us different shades of red. And then we're drawing a line with this color that is centered at the center of canvas. So width divided by 2 and height divided by 2. And then we're drawing it to somewhere on screen. So we're using random to width. So this will give us a number somewhere between 0 and 500 because the width of this canvas is 500. And the height, the other coordinate for the line is going to be between 0 and 500 as well, because y is 500. So this is inside of an active processing script inside of the draw. So 60 times a second, we're going to get a different line of a different reddish color going to somewhere on screen from the center of screen. So let's take a look and see what that looks like. There we go. Reddish lines, all of them starting from the center, but going to random places, random widths and heights on this screen. All right, so that looks pretty cool. Okay, so let's think about min and max. So if we call max with A and B, it's going to return the bigger of the two numbers. And if we call min with A and B, it's going to return the smaller of the two numbers. So here's an example. We create something called int bigger and we call max 100, 200. This is going to put 200 into bigger. If we do int smaller and we call min, then smaller would have 100. And we can sort of nest these things inside of each other. So here we have max of 3 or 5, this is going to be 5, and then we have min of 5 or 4, so this is going to be, this is going to turn out to be 4. Okay, so you might want to wonder, like, when would we use min or max? You can use min to set an upper limit. So if we want to prevent a ball from moving off the right side of the canvas, so what we're doing is we have the ball x position is continually getting some bit added to it. Say it's 10, so ball equals ball plus 10, and that's continually happening. We can make sure that the ball never goes off the right side of the screen by calling min of whatever it's been set to and width minus 1, so width being the width of the canvas. And so if ball x became something like 510 and our canvas is 500 wide, when we get here, 510 and width is 500, so 499, this would actually set ball from being 510, it would switch it to being 499 because this is smaller than 510. And so that would keep the ball on screen, okay? And you could actually just put this addition right into the min call, okay? And similarly, you can do lower limits. And when we're doing lower limits, we don't want anything to go below something. Then we do a max, and we do a max of whatever we're doing, and then we set the limit. So here, to prevent it from moving off the left side of the screen, if we were doing ball minus speed and it was continually getting smaller, we could say, well, we don't ever want it to be negative. So if ball minus speed ended up giving us something like negative 30, then by doing max of that and zero, zero is bigger than negative 30, so that would keep the ball at zero, it would keep it inside the canvas. All right, so let's look at an example of the max and min. So here we have a walls program. And in the walls program, we have a left wall that's at 100 pixels over and a floor that's at 400 pixels down. And we're using max of the wall in the left and min of the left and the width minus our square size. So let's just run this and see what it looks like, and then we'll look back at the code. So here's walls, and we have this square that's following around. It's following our cursor around, okay? But it won't go below this floor, and it won't go left of this wall that we've created. So the wall over here is drawn at left wall zero, left wall floor. So left wall zero down to left wall floor, that's that line. And then the floor is drawn from left wall, the floor, to the width to the floor, okay? And then what we're doing is the left position of where we're drawing this rectangle is either going to be the maximum of the left wall or whatever the left position is based on the cursor, okay? So left gets assigned the x value of the cursor, and then we're saying the min is the wall here. So the min is the cursor or the width minus the square size. So we can't go this way. And then it's max of the left wall and the left. So it always has to be the bigger of this number, 200. So even over here, my cursor over here is 10, but that's smaller than the max, the left wall, which is 100. So that keeps this from going over the wall. Okay, and similarly, for the top top is set as the Y value of the mouse, and so that can be up here, but it can't go below here. So here we've got the min value for this is either whatever the Y is or floor, which is 400 minus the square size, this width here or this height of the square. And that allows us to make sure that the square doesn't go below this floor. So that's the way that you use min and max. Okay. And then one other example I wanted to show you was a something that shows you how to use absolute value. So here we have a program where we're drawing an ellipse that is centered in the screen, and its size is determined by the distance of the cursor from the center of the screen. So mouse X minus width divided by 2 and mouse Y minus height divided by 2. Now, of course, depending on where your mouse was, the distance of the cursor to the center of the screen could be positive or negative in either the X or Y axis. So if we're over here, it's positive width minus the center. But over here, the width, the X position minus the center is actually negative, right? Because right where my cursor is now, it might be 10, but the center of the canvas is 250. So 10 minus 250 would be negative 240. But we want the distance to always be sort of a positive value. So we're taking the absolute value of the cursor position minus the center on in each dimension. And then we're mapping that absolute value to the amount of red. So we're mapping the absolute X distance, the distance horizontally from the center point. The further we are from the center point horizontally, the more red we have. So as we expand out this way, we get more red, okay? And as we expand out this way, we also get more red, and that's because we use the absolute value. So it doesn't matter whether the X cursor coordinate subtracting the center from it is positive or negative, taking the absolute value gives us a positive, and we can map that to the red value, okay? So that's the type of way that you might use the absolute value function. All right. Other things that you might want to look at include the math shortcuts. So it's important to know that there's a notation that's plus equal, and this is just a short form for writing X equals X plus Y. So when we have X plus equals Y, it's just a short form for this. And you can do the same thing with the other math operators. So X plus equals 1 means X equals X plus 1. Ball X plus equals speed means ball X equals ball X plus speed. So it's just taking the thing and adding something to it and storing it back in that thing. So here, X times equal 10 means X becomes X times 10. And X div equals 10 means X becomes X divided by 10. So we do this just to save typing typically. And two other math operators that are sort of shortcuts that you might want to know are incrementing and decrementing. So these can only be applied to a variable. You can't do this to a literal number. And they can be prefix or postfix. And what we mean by that is whether the plus plus or the minus minus comes before or after the variable. So if we do print line x plus plus, it means print x and then add 1 to it. And when we're incrementing or decrementing using these operators, it's always by 1. So the prefix form means increment it and then use it. So if we did print line plus plus x, it means add 1 to x and then print it out. Okay, and you can do the same thing with minus minus. So let's look at processing and see what that looks like. Right, so here we have int x equals 15 and then print line plus plus x. So this is going to add 1 to x and then print it out. It should give us 16. And see, we have 16 down here. But if we do it x plus plus, this just prints out 15, but if we did another print statement afterwards, we would see that after this is run, x is now 16. So now we have 15, the plus plus happens, and the next time we print out x, it's 16. So that's what the plus plus and the minus minus operators do. All right, so that's it for useful math functions in processing. Thanks for watching.